सदाशिव समारंभां शंकराचार्य मध्यमां अस्मदाचार्य पर्यन्तां वंदे गुरु परंपरां श्रुति स्मृति पुराणानां आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पाद शंकरं लोकशंकरं। Page number 9, we are in the shloka, 14th shloka. Tasmat linga paramarashohi anumanam iti stitam avinabhava sambandaha vyaptihi ityavadharyate. And then the commentary, if you look into the commentary, stitam, the meaning for the word stitam is given as tarkashastre nishchitam. It has been ascertained in the Nyaya Shastra that Linga Paramarsha, it is Linga Paramarsha is equated with Paramarsha. Linga Paramarsha is equated with Anumana or the instrument of inferential cognition. Now we are in that juncture. So let me quickly recapitulate whatever we did yesterday. The first step in the comprehension of Anumiti is Paksha Dharmata Jnana, which is nothing but the knowledge of the Hetu in the Paksha. And what is the form of it? Parvataha Dhumavan. The second one is Vyapti Smriti, recollection of Vyapti, which is of the form Yatra Dhumaha Tatra Vannihi. And this Vyapti Smriti, either it could be Anvaya Vyapti Smriti or Vitreka Vyapti Smriti. And we took up for explanation only Anvaya Vyapti. And then we worked out the details. The third one is Paramarsha, which is a complex cognition consisting of, or which is a combination of Paksha Dharmata Jnana and Vyapti Jnana, and how thus we arrived at the Akara of Paramarsha as Sadhya Vyapya Hetuman Ayam Pakshaha. And with reference to specific instance, and from this there arises Pakshaha Sadhyavan. And the specific instances, can anyone of you tell me? Vannivyapya. Yeah, that is general instance. Vannivyapya Dhumavan Ayam Parvataha, from which there arises Parvato Vanniman. Now, we also explained that this is called Sadhyavyapya Hetuman Ayam Pakshaha, is technically referred to as Linga Paramarsha, which means which consists or which involves reference to the Linga or Vyapya or the Hetu. Linga, Vyapya, Hetu, these are all synonyms. So Linga Paramarsha, from Linga Paramarsha there arises Anumiti. Now we have to go further. Let us recall what we explained in the previous one or two previous verses earlier, the definition of Karana. We made a reference to the definition of Karana, Vyaparavat Karanam Karanam. Isn't it? व्यापारवत असाधारणम कारणम करणम. करणा और इंस्ट्रूमेंट इज अ यूनिक कॉज विद इन द फ्रेमवर्क ऑफ कॉजल अपैरेटस. देर आर थ्री कॉजेस इन द सिस्टम ऑफ न्याय. देर आर थ्री कॉजेस एडमिटेड समवाय कारण असमवाय कारण एंड निमित्त कारण. इनहेरेंट कॉज नॉन इनहेरेंट कॉज एंड एफिशियंट कॉज. सो थ्री कॉजेस आर एसेंशियल with regard to the origination of any effect. But among these three causes, there will be one cause which will be given the unique status of a karana or instrument. And how do you determine that which is the unique cause? Because for some, for example, threads give rise to the cloth. But can mere threads give rise to the cloth? It is only the conjunction of the threads that give rise to the cloth. So for some it may appear that without the threads cloth cannot at all come into existence. So for me threads appear to be the important cause. But some might say, what is the use of having threads alone? There must be conjunction of threads. So that appears to be an important cause. So that should be given the status of a karana. So this kind of there is some kind of ambiguity in fixing the karana or the instrument of a particular effect. So that is why we have an obligation to give a clear cut definition for karana, and that we framed as vyaparavat karanam karanam or vyaparavat asadharanam karanam karanam. So we explained how yaga is considered to be the karana for attaining swarga, and what is the vyapara we said apurva or unseen merit. Should I explain that once again? No. So vyapara and apurva is considered to be the vyapara, and yaga is considered to be possessed of vyapara. So vyaparavat karana is yaga, performance of yaga, which gives rise to swarga or heaven. Now extending this kind of explanation in the case, in the present case also, we have to explain that Vyapti Smriti, I am using the word Vyapti Smriti specifically because I don't want to say it is Vyapti Jnana. Means Vyapti Jnana is a common term for both Anubhava and Smriti. So when you are having Pakshadharmata Jnana or knowledge of smoke in the mountain, nobody goes to the kitchen and has an Anubhava to find out that there is the smoke and fire are correlated. So immediately one recollects. It is only recollection of the invariable relation. That is why I use the word specifically Vyapti Smriti. Now, so even if it is said Vyapti Jnana, it must be understood as Vyapti Smriti. Now what happens in the present case? There must be a karana for Anumiti, isn't it? And what is the karana that is given by Nayayikas, that is the later Nayayikas? They have equated Linga Paramarshaha Anumiti Karanam, that is what we said. So Paramarsha is equated with Karana or Anumana. Now this poses a question as to what exactly is the Karana in respect of Anumiti. Now we have got the definition of Karana, we have framed the definition of Karana as Vyaparavat Karanam Karanam. And we have to strictly go by the definition. And if we strictly adhere to this definition, Anumiti is the resultant cognition. Anumiti is the karya or the result that we obtain from the rise of Vyapti Jnana. And now, Vyapti Smriti, earlier we have Pakshadharmata Jnana. And we have Vyapti Smriti. I am not referring to that Pakshadharmata Jnana because there is a combination of the two here, and which has already been stated in the causal apparatus. So that we forget or we take out from the purview. Now Vyapti Smriti and then Paramarsha, as we have already stated, Paramarsha is only a mixture, or it is a unitary cognition, or it's a complex cognition which consists of the two elements or the two components of one Vyapti Jnana, Vyapti Smriti, and another Pakshadharmata Jnana. Now, this being a mixture of the earlier two cognitions, that is Pakshadharvata Jnana and Vyapti Jnana, Paramarsha, can we not say that Paramarsha has arisen from Vyapti Jnana or Vyapti Smriti? Yes. So, this Paramarsha is Tajjanya. Tajjanya means Vyapti Jnana Janya. It is said to arise from Vyapti Jnana. But what is the ultimate result that is expected of Vyapti Smriti or Vyapti Jnana? Is only Anumiti. So, the ultimate result, namely Anumiti, this Paramarsha, which is an intermediate cause, or you call it as Dwara Karana. We must make a twofold distinction of causes as intermediate cause and auxiliary cause. Auxiliary cause in Sanskrit we call as Sahakari Karana, which do not partake of the characteristics, or which do not partake of the characteristics of being a cause. They do not involve reference to the causal apparatus, but they serve as aids in contributing in some form or the other. They are called Sahakari Karanas. But this, in the case of Paramarsha, it is actually involved in the process of the rise of Anumiti. So the Paramarsha, you call it as Dwara Karana or intermediate cause. So this Paramarsha arises from Vyapti Smriti, and in turn it is also the cause of, because without Paramarsha, at least according to the Nayayikas, you cannot think of any Anumiti. If you have Pakshadharmata Jnana and Vyapti Jnana alone, then it rests there. Without the Paramarsha, you can never think of an Anumiti. So, Paramarsha in turn gives rise to Anumiti. Now, we are applying the definition of Vyapara here. Tajjanya means Paramarsha is Vyapti Jnana Janya, and Vyapti Jnana Janya Anumitim Prati Janaka. It is also the cause of Anumiti, which is said to arise from Vyapti Jnana. So, can you not call this Paramarsha as Vyapara? Yes. Now, if Paramarsha is Vyapara, what is the position or status of Vyapti Jnana? It is Vyapara Vat. If it is Vyapara Vat, and it is also a cause, we know, without Vyapti Jnana, you cannot have Anumiti. So, it becomes Vyapara Vat Karana. So, what is the result of this argument? It is termed Karana. Now, it appears from this explanation, since we have explained the definition of Karana as Vyaparavat Karanam Karanam, it appears that it is only Vyapti Smriti or Vyapti Jnana that is the Karana for the rise of Anumiti. But how is it that the text says Linga Paramarshaha Anumitihi Anumanam? That it is the Linga Paramarsha that is the cause of Anumiti. So he has equated the term Anumana with Linga Paramarsha. So it appears that there are two instruments for the rise of Anumiti. One is Vyapti Jnana and the other is Paramarsha. See, one and the same philosopher cannot admit both as Vyapti Jnana as well as Linga Paramarsha as the instruments. So there must be some difference of opinion among the Nayayikas themselves, who hold, some of them holding Vyapti Jnana as the Karana and others holding Paramarsha as the Karana. Now the text says Tasmat Linga Paramarshohi Anumanam iti sthitam, and it is also ascertained by the commentator Tarka Shastre Nishchitam ityartaha. But in the immediately next line he says Vyaparavat Karanam Karanam iti pakshe. Those who maintain the definition of Karana as Vyaparavat Karanam, for them, which is the Karana? Vyapti Jnanam Karanam. So the shloka says tasmat linga para linga paramarsho hi anumanam, but the commentator clarifies, or commentator says vyaparavat karanam karanam iti pakshe vyakti jnanam karanam paramarsho vyaparaha. So the commentator seems to support the view that vyakti jnana is the karana, but the fact remains to be this, that there are two kinds of karana. One, those nayayikas who maintain paramarsha as the karana, and those who maintain vyakti jnana as the karana. Now we have to reconcile both these statements, that is, those who maintain paramarsha as the karana, how is it that they refer to paramarsha as the karana? Because if paramarsha is stated as the karana, then it does not subscribe to the definition of karana, because there is no vyapara, it is not possessed of vyapara vat, it is not possessed of any vyapara, because paramarsha itself is vyapara. So now we have to frame on the Navina Nayayikas, because they have explained paramarsha as the karana of anumiti, they have an obligation to refine or amend the definition of karana. Now, where is the need for this amendment? Why do they not follow vyapti jnana itself as the karana? Isn't it? See, they could have also said vyaparavat karanam karanam. What is the need for framing such a definition? Why should the Navina Nayayikas differ from the earlier Nayayikas at all? They could have also very well said vyaparavat karanam karanam, because after all they belong to the same school. So they are not different from the Nayayikas. If the Advaitins maintain vyaparavat karanam, then it is acceptable. But why do the Nayayikas themselves refined or amended the definition of karana? You see, the Prachina Nayayikas, they were concentrating very much on the metaphysical aspect of the system, whereas the Navina Nayayikas shifted their emphasis in the epistemological aspect. So they look into the subtleties and nuances of logic, and they don't want any single concept to go astray. So they just kannila valaka nevutundi, that is, they just want to peep into each and every point of it, and they want to bring out the essence of it. So what they did was, the definition of pratyaksha, Professor R.B. was referring to the definition of pratyaksha according to the Nayayikas yesterday, indriyartha sannikarsha janyam jnanam pratyaksham. Perceptual cognition is that which arises from the interaction of the sense organs with the respective object. So what is expected sense of sight when it has to perceive an object, say pot? There is gata pratyaksha. So sense of sight comes into contact with the object, and they have accepted six types of contacts, that is laukika pratyaksha. These are all laukika pratyaksha. He also referred to alaukika pratyaksha, alaukika sannikarshas. Now this is laukika pratyaksha. The sense of sight comes into contact, and this contact is conjunction or samyoga. Now any substance, when it is cognized, you cannot conceive of the cognition of a substance without being related to color. If it is visual perception, then it has to possess color. Udbhuta rupam nayanasya gocharaha. So when you are perceiving pot, pot as associated with color is perceived. Now all these, the perception takes place simultaneously, but yet in order to understand, we make a distinction in the context through which they have been perceived. Now the color of the pot, how is it related to the pot? Through the relation of inherence or samavaya. No, the same sense organ, sense of sight, perceives the pot as associated with color. Otherwise, he would not have perceived pot at all. Because without being related to a color, you cannot have the visual perception of any object. You cannot perceive air because it is devoid of color. So, now, what is the type of contact through which you perceive the color of the pot? It is samyukta samavaya, they say. That means, this is the contact, samyukta samavaya, which means the sense of sight is conjoined with the pot. The sense of sight is conjoined with the pot, wherein color is related through samavaya or inherence. So, chakshu samyuktaha gataha tatra rupam samavetam. So, pot is conjoined with the, or sense of sight, pot is conjoined with the sense of sight, wherein color is related through the relation of inherence. So, the relation takes the form, or the relation is of the kind samyukta samavaya. So, he goes on to explain six types of contact. Now, my point of interest is, I want to say this, through the sense of hearing, that is Shrotraindriya, perceives sound. It is auditory perception, Shabda Pratyaksha. Now, this Shabda is confined only to ether according to the Nyaya school. Unlike the Vedantins, who admit sound to be present in all the five elements, for the Nayayikas, it is confined only to the ether. Shabda Gunakam Akasham means Shabda is present only in Akasha. So, it is confined to ether. Now, through the sense of hearing, you perceive the sound, and what is the contact through which it is perceived? It is samavaya or inherence. Why? Why is it the relation of samavaya? Because sound is a quality for the nayayikas. And now, what is sense of hearing? Shrotra. It is of the nature of ether, because the Shrotraindriya is defined as the etheric space conditioned by the cavity of the ear. There is ether inside. So those who have this cavity alone cannot have the sense of hearing. It is the etheric space that has to function. The etheric space inside the cavity of the ear, that is referred to as Shrotraindriya. Karna Shashkuli Avachinnam Nabaha Shrotram. Nabaha means the akasha or the etheric space, which is conditioned by this Karna Shashkuli, means the cavity of the ear, that is referred to as Shrotra. Shrotratvam Vidiyate. Kutra Karna Shashkuli Akasha Muddishya Shrotratvam Vidiyate. That is Shrotraindriya. So if the sense of hearing is of the nature of ether, ether has been classified under substance, isn't it? Prithivya, Tejo, Vayu, Akasha, Kala, Dik, Atma, Manamsi, Navaiva. So in that list, what is given? Shakasha falls under substance. Now, the Nayayikas have accepted samavaya or inherence between five pairs, of which one pair is between substances and qualities, there is samavaya. Substances are related, or qualities are related to the substances through the relation of samavaya. Now, with this at the back of the mind, you have to understand ether being a substance, sound being a quality, what could be the relation and what is the only possible relation? Samavaya, because guna guninoho samavayaha. So all this is okay as long as it does not pose any problem. But now the Navya-Nayayikas, what they thought, now we have to apply the definition of Karana here, because we have to say what is the Pratyaksha Jnana Karanam, Pratyaksham we have given. Now what is the Karana in respect of Pratyaksha? This is Pratyaksha Prama. Pratyaksha Prama means auditory perception. Auditory perception, Professor Arbi was also making reference. It is normally misunderstood. Wherever you have visual perception, there alone it is perception. It is not the case. Auditory perception, tactual perception, gustatory perception. So everything is perception. Whatever that is perceived through the external sense organs, they have to be called as perception. But it is being narrowed down or restricted to understand. Normally any layman will be understanding that it refers only to visual perception. It's not the case. So it is auditory perception. Now, there is the perceptual cognition of sound, and it arises from the sense of hearing. And what is the contact? It is samavaya. Now, you have to explain which is the karana. Pratyaksha jnana karanam pratyaksham. What is pratyaksha pramana? According to the Nyaya school, you have to say prama karanam pramanam. Now, what is the pratyaksha prama you have here? It is the auditory perception of sound. Now, how does it arise? It arises from the interaction of the sense organ. And what is the contact through which you are able to cognize the sound? It is samavaya. Now, apply the definition of karana here. What is the definition so far we have learnt? Vyaparavat karanam karanam. Now, vyaparavat karanam karanam means what is the result that has to be obtained? Auditory perception of sound. From which sense organ? Sense of hearing. Now, the sense of hearing through the intermediate cause of samavaya, this is dwarakarana, just as we explained paramarsha as the dwarakarana, so also samavaya, if we have to apply the definition of vyaparava dasadharanam karanam karanam, then we have to say tat janya means shrotrendriya janyatve sati, shrotrendriya janya shabdam prati janakatvat samavayaha vyaparaha. Isn't it? We are just applying the definition, that is all. Now, if samavaya is the vyapara, what is vyapara? What? Shrotra indriya is vyapara. You have to extend this line of explanation in all cases of perception. Even in the case of sense of sight, conjunction is the vyapara. Since chakshu indriya is possessed of such a vyapara, that is to be called as vyaparavat asadharanam karanam. So in this way, all the sense organs will be treated as karana. That is why the last sentence, if you look into the Pratyaksha Paricheda, last sentence of Tarka Sangraha Pratyaksha Paricheda, he concludes by saying, Tasmat Indriyam Pratyaksha Pramanam. It may appear because Indriyam, how can you call Indriya as Pratyaksha Pramanam? Normally we associate Pramana means something like axe or... It is not the Indriyam Pratyaksha Pramana. All the sense organs constitute Pratyaksha Pramana for the Nayayikas. Professor R.B. also made a reference to another type of definition, Jnana Akaranakam Jnanam Pratyaksham. When you contrast Pratyaksha with the other three kinds of Anubhava, Anumiti, Upamiti and Shabda, Shabda Jnana, they have for their instruments some kinds of knowledge. Vyapti Jnanam is the Karana for Anumiti. Sadrishya Jnana, knowledge of similarity, is that which gives rise to Upamiti. And then Pada Jnana gives rise to Shabda Bodha, verbal cognition. But, so these three, that is when contrasted with Pratyaksha, Anumiti, Upamiti and Shabda Jnana, they have some other cognitions as their instrument. So they are all Jnana Karanakani. Whereas, how is Pratyaksha? It does not have any other knowledge as its instrument. It has Indriyas or the sense organs as the instrument. So in Pratyaksha, as distinguished from the other three kinds of Pramanas, Pratyaksha Pramana is, Pratyaksha Prama is Jnana Akaranaka. So, Jnana Akaranakam Jnanam Pratyaksham. So now, coming back to this vyaparat karanam karanam, now all these, that is why tasmat indriyam pratyaksha pramana, when it is said that indriyas constitute, the sense organs constitute pratyaksha pramana, that means at the back of the prachina nayayikas he has this definition vyaparavat karanam karanam, that is how all the indriyas would be called karana. But the Navina Nayayikas, as I mentioned earlier, they are very, they look into the subtleties and nuances, they go line by line, they just analyze all this. So when they, with the colored glasses, when they looked into it appears in the case of the first kind of contact, sense of sight, giving rise to samyoga, which in turn gives rise to the perceptual knowledge of part, it is okay. But in between you have samyukta samaveta samavaya, and then the fourth one is samavaya, which we have now explained, which these contacts involve reference to the concept of samavaya. In the case of samyoga, Nayayikas have admitted these two relations, very important relations. But look at this, the relation of samavaya has been given a prominent place of category, of an independent category, while samyoga, which is a relation, has been subdued in the qualities. Of course, it is a category, but an independent status of a padartha has been assigned to samavaya because it is the mortar which binds all the bricks of the nyaya system. Because without samavaya, the system falls to the ground. Without samavaya, you can never build the fort of the Nayayikas. So it has been assigned a very unique and important place, samavaya. So such a samavaya is admitted as eternal relation by the Nayayikas. Now, unknowingly or unconsciously, the Prachina Nayayikas have not given thought to it. They have explained that this is a vyapara tadjanyatva. If you have to express that it is janya, it goes against their own spirit, that is, samavaya is an eternal relation. You cannot admit it to be janya. So, noticing this difficulty, the Navina Nayayikas thought of a need to amend the definition of karana. My teacher always used to say, the Nyaya school, in a jocular sense, the Nayayikas will create a cat, a hat. If the hat does not fit the head, they won't change the size of the hat, but you have to chisel your head. So this is how the Nayayikas have trained themselves. So what happens here is, so this is the difficulty, the problem posed. Are you able to understand the problem posed here? Because samavaya cannot satisfy the definition of vyapara. Is it all right? So samavaya cannot be considered as vyapara, and as a result of which sense organs cannot be said to be vyaparavat. So tasmat indriyam pratyaksha pramanam, it goes against this statement, indriyam pratyaksha pramanam. So now what the Navina Nayayikas did, they do not have any sentiments. See, all these days we have been telling vyaparavat karanam karanam, how to leave off this definition and go for a new definition. Would it look nice on my part to do so? Such a sentiment is not at all there for them. If it does not fit into, then get out. You don't have a place here. So I will frame a new definition. I have got my intellect. So he says, the definition of karana is parayoga vyavachinnam karanam karanam. Don't be afraid of this phrase. It is very simple. It only means karana is one, फलायोग व्यवच्छिन्नम कारणम करणम। He has simplified the process now. He says, what is a karana? A karana is one which immediately precedes the rise of the effect. Pala means result. Ayoga vyavachinna means avyavagita purva vritti, that which immediately precedes the rise of the effect. Pala ayoga vyavachinna means this term. It means in Sanskrit it is avyavahita purvavritti. Or in English it means that which immediately precedes. Now, viewed in the light of this definition, in the present instance of our sense of hearing, samavaya and sound, what would you call as the instrument? What immediately precedes the rise of the perceptual cognition of sound? What exists is samavaya. What exists? Because prior to the rise of, you see, he maintains the same samavaya as samavaya, but he has shifted, or he has made a shift of the definition without including the phrase tajanyatva or vyaparavat. Only if you openly make a statement or a pronouncement that samavaya is vyaparavat, all these things, you have an obligation to explain that samavaya is janya, all these. Now, without, it is an objective definition, without including the phrase of janyatva, he makes a different definition, which means that which precedes the rise of the effect, immediately precedes. That's what immediately precedes. Avyavahita purvavritti. Para ayoga vyavachinna means that which immediately precedes the rise of the effect. That is karana, means all the sense contacts. Now you can no more maintain indriyas as pratyaksha pramana according to this view. All the sense contacts which immediately precede the rise of the result, they would be termed karana. Now, extending this, because once you have changed the definition, Navinayayikas have changed the definition of karana, they have to maintain. Only in one place it is Vyapti Jnana, in another place it is Parayoga Vyavachina, Paramarsha, he cannot maintain. So, the Navinayayikas, extending this kind of explanation, in the case of the rise of Animiti also, what have they explained? They have explained Paramarsha as the karana. Because prior to the rise of Anumiti, what exists is Paramarsha. Because Vyapti Smriti gives rise to Paramarsha. And Paramarsha is a necessary condition for the Nayayikas. Without Paramarsha, there is no Anumiti. So, Pala, what is Pala? Pala is Anumiti. Pala Ayoga Vyavacheda, Pala Ayoga Vyavachinnam Karanam, means Avyavahita Purvavrittihi Paramarsha. So this paramarsha is the karana. So whenever you come across the phrase vyapti jnanam karanam, immediately you have to refer to vyaparavat asadharanam karanam karanam. If on the other hand paramarsha is referred to as the karana of anumiti, then immediately you should be in a position to say that it is according to the Navina Nayayikas, that is pala ayoga vyavachinnam karanam karanam. That he makes a mention in this text, Vyaparavat Karanam Karanam Iti Pakshe. Please look into the text. Page 9. Vyaparavat Karanam Karanam Iti Pakshe Vyapti Jnanam Karanam Paramarshaha Vyaparaha. And then he makes the statement, Palayoga Vyavachedi Karanam Karanam Iti Pakshe. Why to leave of this? That is not given. We have to supply. Why should there be another definition at all? That we have stated, the difficulty that is posed by the Navina Nayayikas and the need for such an amendment we have stated now, we have referred to now. So, he just goes to the other alternative. Palayoga vyavachedi karanam karanam iti pakshe लिंग परामर्श योग करणम इति मंतव्यम यू हैव टू कंक्लूड विद दैट एंड इन विद दैट इन व्यू द टेक्स्ट द द द श्लोक द वर्स सेज तस्मात् लिंग परामर्शो हि अनुमानम इति स्थितम बट ही हेसन्स टू ऐड द कमेंटेटर हेसन्स टू ऐड सर प्लीज डोंट थिंक दैट वी फॉलो दिस मेथड वी फॉलो दिस व्यू अस्मत् सिद्धांते सी दैट That royal we know, he says, Asmat Siddhanta, we do not fall in line with the Nyaya school. Asmat Siddhanta, we do not follow the school of Navya Nayayikas. Because, see, what is the danger there? If he follows the Navya Nayayikas, he has to admit Paramarsha. Advaitins have to admit Paramarsha, which they don't do. Isn't it? So, Asmat Siddhanta, Vyapti Jnanam Eva Karanam. Because he does not leave you in ambiguity. There is no vague. There. He says, Asmat Siddhanta Tu. The Advaitins, however, maintain Vyapti Jnana as the Karanam. How? On the basis of what? Vyaparavat Karanam Karanam. Now, the question remains as to what is the Vyapara. If you maintain Vyaparavat Karanam Karanam, and if you don't admit Paramarsha also, then what is the Vyapara you are going to provide? To the rise of animity. Because Vyaparavat, if you want to maintain Vyapti Smriti as one possessed of Vyaparavat, then what is the Vyapara? We have been so far telling that Paramarsha is the Vyapara. But Paramarsha is not admitted by the Advaitins. They don't want to admit Paramarsha. Why? That is again pure logic. It is only a combination of the earlier Pakshadharmata Jnana and Vyapti Smriti. What is the fun in just putting a knot as it were with the two cognitions and just naming it as Paramarsha? I don't want to say Paramarsha. So Vyapti Smriti, yet Vyapti Smriti is the Karana. So the Advaitins have to give or provide something as the Vyapara here, by means of which you can say that this Vyapti Jnana will be Vyaparavat, and so the resultant cognition Anumiti would arise from Vyapti Jnanam. So, Asmat Siddhanta Tu Vyapti Jnanam Eva Karanam means Eva Karena Paramarsha Vyavrittihi or Paramarsha Vyavachedaha. It is not Paramarsha that is the Karanam. Then immediately the commentator knows, no? Because immediately the reader will have a doubt. Then what would be the Vyapara? So he says, Tat samskara vyapara iti dhyayam. Vyapti samskara is the. Now, we forget for a while this paramarsha. Now, from this Nyayaika school, we have jumped into Advaita. Now, what is the vyapara? Is Vyapti samskara. From out of smriti also there would arise samskara. That's what we have said earlier. It is not that experience alone gives rise to samskara, but smriti also could give rise to samskara, isn't it? Whenever that smriti goes away, it is bound to leave samskara. Now, he says, Vyapti samskara, tat samskara, vyapara iti bodhyam. Now, since this is provided as vyapara, Vyapti smriti janya tve sati, Vyapti jnana janya anumitim prati janakatvat, this is vyapara. So this is vyapara vat. And hence, this Vyapti jnana is called karana. That is why asmat siddhanta tu Vyapti jnana meva karanam tat samskaraha vyaparaha iti bodhyam. Now, there are some more discussions regarding that. I don't go into the details because if Vyapti Samskara, and I'm just initiating that problem here. If Vyapti Samskara is the Vyapara, and this Anumiti is said to arise from Vyapti Samskara, isn't it? Samskara Janyam Jnanam Smritihi, this is the definition we have given. So, Anumitehe Smritittva Apattihi. This is a question posed and it is answered also. I don't go into that detail. Why I want to say this? The problem does not end there. It keeps on going. Is it clear? So that samskara, vyavara, but for the present, we will be able to understand this much, that samskara is avantara vyapara and vyapti jnana is vyaparavat, and hence asmat siddhante, advaita siddhante, vyapti jnana meva karanam. So what is the def karana for the advaitins? It is vyaparavat asadharanam karanam karanam. And then this is the first line, tasmat linga paramarshohi anumanam iti sthitam. And then the second line says, avinabhava sambandha vyaptihi tyavadharyate. Avadharyate means nischiyate. It is ascertained. What is ascertained? It is ascertained as vyapti. What is vyapti? Avinabhava sambandha. So far we have been giving the definitions of the different types of vyapti. But what in general? How do you define vyapti in general? There are books and books written over and above the definition of vyapti. With regard to the definition of vyapti, in Tarka Sangra you just have an epigrammatic statement, Sahacharya Niyamaha Vyapti, that is the definition of vyapti. But the definition goes on and on and on. Pura Paksha Vyapti, there are five definitions of Pura Paksha Vyapti, and each succeeding definition has been refined in order to overcome some difficulty in the earlier definition, and another 14 definitions have been framed by several logicians. This is a mind-breaking exercise. People may think, where is the need for to study this at all? If such a question is put, there is no answer for it. There is no need at all, no. One can live happily without reading logic, isn't it? But such a kind of mental exercise is also necessary to have clarity of thought. So that is why we have embarked upon such a study. So now, tat samskara, now para, 14 definitions have been framed, then 14 plus 5, 19 definitions. At the end of the 19th definition, one Pura Pakshi poses a question. All these definitions do not hold good in one case. Kevalan vainya bhavat. In a sadhetu, this definition does not fit in. So he gives Siddhanta Vyapti Lakshana, that is Nyaya Siddhanta, we who have framed the conclusive definition of Vyapti. And for that, again, there is one text, Siddhanta Vyapta, Siddhanta Lakshana, Siddhanta Lakshana, there is one text. All these texts are around 300 to 400 pages with the commentary. You have Panchalakshani, you have Chaturdashalakshani, and you have. Why I am telling the range of the subject I just wanted to give, it does not rest with Sahacharya Niyamaha Vyaptihi or Avinabhava Sambandha, very, very innocent line, Avinabhava Sambandha. It has invoked so much of discussion that it goes on. You have got separate texts for these subjects. So, kim lakshanam? Now, paramarsha gataka vyapti jnana vishaya vyaptehe kim lakshanam iti jignyasayam. Now, we have so far dealt with the definition of paramarsha. Paramarsha gataka. Gataka means that which involves reference to in the definition of paramarsha, there is the reference to what is known as vyapti jnana. So, vyapti jnana involves reference, paramarsha involves reference to the vyapti jnana. So, paramarsha gataka vyapti jnana. And vyapti jnana means jnana must be possessed of a vishaya or content, isn't it? If you speak of jnana, then it must relate to a content. So, vyapti jnana vishaya. So, what is the vishaya of vyapti jnana? Vyapti is the vishaya. So, vyapti jnana vishaya vyaptehe. Kim lakshanam? What is the definition of vyapti? Kim lakshanam? Iti jignyasaya. When you have such a jignyasa, jnatamiccha, jignyasayam, tal lakshanamaha, avinabhaveti, avyabhijarita sadhya samanadhikaranyam vyaptihi. Swamiji, shall I go for 10 more minutes or should I stop here? Sir, da solananke. Da, varayu uru line da arukku. So, avinabhava sambandha, he says, avyabhijarita sadhya samanadhikaranyam vyaptihi. This is a very simple form of the Siddhanta Vyapti, which has been stated here. The Siddhanta Vyapti follows the anvaya type of vyapti, which does not at all involve reference to the sadhya bhava. Because we have referred to two types of vyapti. What are they? Anvaya vyapti and vyatireka vyapti. Now, if you have to say vyatireka vyapti, then naturally you have to mention sadhya bhava and hetva bhava. But this will pose a problem. Why? There are three types of sadhetus: anvaya vyatireki, kevala anvayi, and kevala vyatireki. So there are certain instances of hetus which have only anvaya vyapti. Gataka, for instance, pot is nameable because it is knowable. There is an instance of kevala anvayi, pot is nameable because it is knowable. Now, this nameability and knowability, these two are accepted by the Nyaya school as kevalanvayi padarthas, which means you cannot postulate the absence of these two in any substratum. That means all objects are knowable under the sun and all objects are nameable also. All the padarthas are nameable as dravya, guna, karma, samanya, vishesha, samavaya, abhava. And all can come within the range of cognition also. So, in such cases, what would happen is, you cannot speak of the sadhya bhava at all. There is no abhideyatva abhava. Nameable means abhideya. So, you cannot speak of abhideyatva abhava. So, as a result of which, there is no possibility of vyatireka vyapti at all. So, the definition of vyapti should be such that it does not involve reference to the sadhya bhava at all. But unfortunately, what happened is all the purapaksha vyapti, definition of purapaksha vyapti, they have reference to one type of abhava or the other. Either it is bheda, anyonya bhava, or it is atyanta bhava. So all the five types of vyapti, definitions of vyapti, involve reference to some types of abhava. So the Nayayikas have totally given up all these five definitions, and finally they saw to it that there is no element of abhava, or at least sadhya bhava, involved in the definition of the Siddhanta Vyapti. So a very, very simple form of the definition of Siddhanta Vyapti is, says, sadhya samanadikaranya, which means sadhya samanadikaranya karanyam vyaptihi, which means the sadhya, or that which is established, sadhya samanadikaranyam means it does not say where the definition is to be construed. Whenever we speak of the definition of vyapti, this we have to bear in mind. Vyaptehe lakshanam kutra anveti. Vyaptehe lakshanam kutra samanvayaha kartavyaha. Where should you construe the definition? Where should you apply the definition of vyapti? Where should you apply the definition? What has vyapti? It is the hetu that has the vyapti. Vyapyaha. Vyapya padartha is the hetu. Vyapyaha means vyapti vishishtaha. That which is associated with the vyapti is the vyapya padartha or the hetu. Kasya vyapti vishishtaha, sadhyasya vyapti vishishtaha. It has the vyapti of the sadhya. So, it is always the hetu that has the vyapti of the sadhya. So, sadhya vyapyaha hetu, when you say, Dhuma has got the vyapti with the sadhya. So, sadhya samanadikaranyam vyaptihi, when you say, this sadhya samanadikaranyam means sadhya adhikarana vrittitvam. That is, the presence of something in the sadhya adhikarana, or in the substratum of sadhya. And what is to be present here? The hetu. Because you are applying the definition only in the hetu. What should have sadhya samanadikaranyam? It is the hetu that should possess sadhya samanadikaranyam. So, sadhya samanadikaranyam means, what is the sadhya in the present instance? Is fire. Where does fire exist? In a kitchen. And where, there, what is also present is smoke. Is it clear? So, sadhya samanadhikaranyam vyapti. This is very basically he started with. Sadhya samanadhikaranyam vyapti. But the student is a trained nayayika. So, immediately he asked the question. Sadhya samanadhikaranyam, when you speak, sir, you are very clever. You are always taking a substratum wherein you can show the presence of smoke. Why cannot we take sadhya adhikaranam means ayogolaka also? There fire is present, isn't it? Glowing iron rod. Now sadhya adhikarana is glowing iron rod. Is smoke present there? No. So, if you provide the definition sadhya samanadhikaranya as vyakti, no doubt it is applicable in smoke. But you can also say, point out this iron rod as the adhikarana of fire where you don't have smoke at all. So there is at least one instance where you cannot prove the vyakti. If you were to consider this definition, you see, there is, it's not going to be the case that there is no vyakti at all. It is there. But at least in one instance, if you have to maintain this definition, at least in one instance, you cannot prove this vyapti. Because if you have always to prove the existence or ascertain this in a particular instance. So that is why there is a need for prefixing this sadhya with an adjective. That adjective is avinabhava sadhya samanadhikaranyam. That's what he has given. That avinabhava is avyabhicharita sadhya samanadhikaranyam. Avyabhicharita. The sadhya is prefixed with an adjective. Avyabhicharita sadhya samanadhikaranyam. Means avyabhicharita means this sadhya which has coexistence with the. See how it is helpful for us now. Whatever exercises we have done in the previous classes, now that is going to help us now. Avyabhicharita sadhya means hetu vyapaka, that hetu which does not lack correspondence with the sadhya, or that sadhya which always coexists with the hetu. Hetu vyapaka sadhya. What have we stated earlier? Sadhya vyapyaha hetu means, what does it mean? Hetu vyapakaha sadhya. So, hetu vyapaka sadhya samanadhikaranyam. Avyabhicharita. Avinabhava means avyabhicharita. And avyabhicharita means hetu vyapaka sadhya samanadhikaranyam. Means wherever the hetu is present. And there this sadhya is present. It is such a sadhya. Now see how we are able to overcome this. Now if mere sadhya is given there, then you will consider even ayogolaka as the substratum. Because there is nothing given as adjective. Now that you have prefixed the word sadhya with this hetu vyapaka sadhya, that means what is the substratum of hetu is only mahanasa or kitchen. And what is present there is fire. So, the fire which is present in the substratum of Dhuma, namely in kitchen, it is such a sadhya samanadhikaranyam when you say, naturally you have to consider the substratum of fire here also as kitchen and not ayogolaka. So, it is to ward off this kind of defect. That is, so as not to consider ayogolaka or glowing iron rod as the substratum of fire, that you prefix or you give the adjective to the sadhya as avinabhava sadhya samanadhikaranyam or avyabhicharita sadhya samanadhikaranyam, which in other words, in simple words, it means hetu vyapaka sadhya samanadhikaranyam vyaptihi. So this is what is given in the commentary. Avinabha avyabhicharita sadhya samanadhikaranyam vyaptihi ityartaha. Ukta lakshanam lakshe sangamayati. That the construing of this definition we will see in the next class. Now I think I have